Get great deals throughout the store at Safeway. This week at Safeway, get mega packs of bone-in USDA choice beef, New York strip steaks for $5.97 per pound with digital coupon. Limit two packages. Plus, Haas avocados are 10 for $10, member price. Also, this week at Safeway, mix or match 12 packs of 12-ounce cans or 8 packs of 12-ounce bottles of Coca-Cola, Pepsi, 7-Up, or Dr. Pepper are buy two, get three free. Limit three free items, member price plus CRV. Visit Safeway.com or head in store for more deals.
New on Curiosity Stream, we've walked with dinosaurs. We've explored our prehistoric planet, and we were always told the same story. Extinction came from the sky. But what if dinosaurs survived? Amazing Dino World 2. Watch it now on Curiosity Stream. With monthly, annual, and bundle plans, find the one that works for you at curiositystream.com.
Welcome, friends. It's the Movie Film Podcast. Enjoy the show. Zaki and Brian are talking about movies. Movie Film Podcast on the radio.
Welcome to a movie film commentary track. My name is Zaki Hassan. I'm here with Brian Hall.
Hey, how's it going, Zaki?
Hey, I'm looking forward to showing some monkey love.
Me too.
So today's commentary track is one that we got a request for, and it was one that I eagerly accepted, and Brian, I'm assuming, slightly less eagerly accepted.
I wouldn't say less eager. I know that I have less to contribute to this, but I was just telling Zaki off air, this is true. I know that the Planet of the Apes series, I'm intrigued by it, and I've only seen three of the five films, and I like them. And so I'm actually looking forward to sitting down with you and hearing you talk through this movie, you know, to me and the audience. Like, I want to know what's up in that brain of yours and apply it. Because I really enjoyed this movie, so I'm looking forward to seeing what you can apply to it.
Ironically, what is in my brain is a toy monkey that claps cymbals together. That's just about it.
Perfect.
So we are here to talk about Beneath the Planet of the Apes, released in 1970. This movie is celebrating its 50th anniversary this year.
Wow.
Kind of crazy. And anyone who has listened to this show for any great length of time knows that the original 1968 Planet of the Apes is my very favorite movie of all time. And I've seen it an ungodly amount of times over the years. I don't even know how many times I've seen it, Brian.
Well, actually, I wanted to rewatch it before we did this just to kind of, you know, keep up the integrity of going through this series, but I wasn't able to. But I remember it relatively well.
Well, and that film was, in fact, the very first commentary track we ever did on this podcast.
Wow, was it really?
It was. We recorded that together in person 6 years ago.
I remember doing that. I'd forgotten that was the absolute first one.
Wow. Yeah. In 2014, can you believe that?
No.
So
amazing.
So we're here to talk through the second film in the series. And this film is a fascinating one. It truly is. And I'm not saying that, like, damning with faint praise. I think the fact that it exists in the form that it does, about the things that it's about, is fascinating to me on a whole variety of levels, especially because it is a G-rated family movie.
Yeah. G was a... It's funny how ratings sort of evolve over time, what they come to represent, isn't it?
Yes.
Very much so. I watched something the other day. Oh, I don't even remember what it was, but it was PG-13, and I was like, why?
Right.
It's kind of felt like PG, but it feels like people don't want a PG rating anymore because it doesn't mean what it used to.
That's right. Yeah. So you know, there's a lot to talk about here, and I'm looking forward to going through it. So for those of you listening, if you do feel like watching Beneath the Planet of the Apes along with us, feel free. You know, if not, we'll certainly try to keep our conversation interesting enough that this episode is worth listening to even without you needing to be plop down in front of your TV.
Yeah.
So let's take a short break so our sponsors can do their thing, and then we'll come back and we will start the movie.
Get great deals throughout the store at Safeway. This week at Safeway, get megapacks of bone-in USDA choice beef, New York strip steaks for $5.97 per pound with digital coupon. Limit two packages. Plus, Haas avocados are 10 for $10, member price. Also, this week at Safeway, mix or match 12 packs of 12-ounce cans or 8 packs of 12-ounce bottles of Coca-Cola, Pepsi, 7-Up, or Dr. Pepper are buy two, get three free. Limit three free items, member price plus CRV. Visit Safeway.com or head in store for more deals.
With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to... Has anyone seen the bride and groom?
Sorry, sorry, we're here. We were getting lucky in the limo and we lost track of time.
No, Lucky Land Casino, with cash prizes that add up quicker than a guest registry.
In that case, I pronounce you lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Daily bonuses are waiting. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
All right, we're back. So Brian, you ready to throw some poop?
I'm ready.
All righty. I was going to ask if you were ready to masturbate, but that would not be the same. Monkeys likely masturbate.
Is that a monkey thing?
It is a monkey thing. Really? You didn't know that?
I guess so. I don't know. I guess I don't hear it as much as the throwing poop thing, but it rings a bell.
They masturbate and throw poop, and maybe it's just me because I went to the Oakland Zoo about 2 years ago.
Are you serious?
And my second kid was like, "What's that monkey doing?" I was like,
"No kidding.
He's scratching."
Wow. I remember that from The Simpsons, you know, zookeeper, zookeeper.
Yeah, yeah.
Those monkeys are trying to kill each other.
Yeah. But, No. No.
I guess I haven't been to enough zoos.
I don't like going to zoos, and that might be part of the reason why.
Yeah, I can understand that.
It stays with you. Yeah. But anyway, we went off on a tangent early.
Well, let's just answer this. Yes and yes.
All righty, so here we go. We are queued up and ready to go, and we will press play on three. So, Brian, mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3, play.
All right. Now, this is the only Apes film that does not have the 20th Century Fox logo at the beginning?
Actually, the only film that does have the 20th Century Fox logo at the beginning is the first one.
Oh!
Yeah, none of the sequels have the, which is interesting, right? Because that was something, I mean, we do sort of ineffably associate it with that company, but for a stretch there, I guess several films didn't.
And now, they were in sort of tough times at this moment, right?
This movie was made primarily out of desperation because the studio needed money and franchise money was the way to go. Mm-hmm. Worth mentioning here, this is the what we're watching here is the end of the original film. And we just saw Roddy McDowell reading, you know, the scripture from the Sacred Scrolls. Now, Roddy McDowell does not appear in this film in the new footage. The role of Cornelius is played by an actor named David Watson. However, by virtue of him being in the prologue here, technically, you can say Roddy McDowell has been in every one of the original Planet of the Apes movies.
Is he credited?
He is not. He is not. And the calculation that the filmmakers made, Roddy McDowell, it was not for lack of interest. It was a scheduling issue.
Right.
And the calculus was, well, let's just put another guy in a monkey suit and, you know, nobody will know the difference. And I think, for the most part, I would say that calculation proved accurate because, I mean, did you know it's not Roddy McDowell in this when you watched it?
No.
Yeah. You know? I think Roddy McDowell is a very integral part of why the latter films work, certainly everyone after this one. But, mm-hmm. I mean, this was still Charlton Heston's show, even though his role in this is pretty much a cameo.
Mm-hmm.
The guy they cast, you know, as the new astronaut is kind of like, you know, made-for-TV Heston.
Right, he really is.
You know?
Yeah. Which, by the way, I just want to point out, this is Point Doom Beach up in
Yes.
Malibu.
You've been there.
Yeah. Yeah, and I went here. I was working on a movie, that Christopher Guest movie, For Your Consideration, and they did a scene where these pilgrims were coming to America. Mm-hmm. And I was at this beach and had no idea.
How funny.
Would have been kind of cool to know.
Right.
That's where the Statue of Liberty was.
You could be like, damn you all to hell.
Yeah, yeah. Like, Brian, get out of the shot.
So, like I said, this is following, you know, the Rocky movie approach of, like, let's start the new movie with the end of the previous movie.
I like it. I think it makes sense.
Well, and I think it highlights the continuity, and it also probably allows him to save, like, a little bit of screen time, because
didn't even think of that. Yeah.
There's like 4 minutes that they don't have to worry about. Now, making a sequel to Planet of the Apes was not something that was part of the calculus when the first movie was being made.
Yeah, because it was based on a book, correct?
It was based on a book.
And were there any other books?
No.
Was it a series, or was it?
Yeah, and the original film was very different from the book. But even mm-hmm. still, I mean, it reached a point where, you know, there's not to say that there wasn't room to come up with something, which obviously they did, but I mean, it wasn't conceived that way, and maybe that's just a reflection of the cinema mindset then, where I mean, especially now, right, everything is a prefabricated trilogy or a prefabricated shared universe, right back then the movie comes out and it's a substantial hit. It's embraced critically and with audiences, and so right away it's, oh well, you guys should do a sequel. And,
sure.
And that was, at the time, that was not something that was, you know, as commonplace as it is now.
Right. Let's make Patton 2.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Yeah. So, well, speaking of Patton, now Patton was directed by Franklin D. Schaffner, who directed the first Apes movie. And so as a result of him, after Apes, going off to do Patton, he was unable to come back for this film.
Oh, okay.
And so they brought in Ted Post, who you know, he's kind of a journeyman director, you know. He also did, shortly after this, actually, maybe a couple of years later, he did Magnum Force, which is the second Dirty Harry movie.
Right, right.
So he's like the guy to make the first sequel to the iconic first film, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And right here we have the screenplay by Paul Dane. Paul Dane ended up writing... or having some story credit in all the remaining films, but he ended up.
Oh,
writing,
really?
Yeah, he. I mean, he became kind of the guiding force story wise for the rest of the series. Mm-hmm. But they didn't go to him first; they went to Rod Serling first.
And for this one.
For this one, because of course Rod Serling co-wrote the first one. They also went to Pierre Boulle, who wrote the novel, the original Planet of the Apes novel.
Can I ask you a couple questions?
You certainly can.
Just because it's been 6 years since we did the last Apes commentary. What was the original ending in the novel for the book?
The original novel, and so the novel is told with a double framing device. So you have these astronauts in space who are on a vacation. They're vacationing mm-hmm. in space. So it's like a yacht, a space yacht, basically. And they find mm-hmm. a bottle. And so they retrieve the bottle, and in the bottle is a message. And the message is like, I hope somebody gets this so that, you know, my story can be told. And it's, they read the story, and it's this astronaut who's like, you know, I was on this journey, I went to this planet, and it's crazy. And it was like talking monkeys, and it's crazy. And then I went back to Earth, and in the time it took for me to go and come back, Earth had turned into an ape planet. And that's where we're at. That's like the story. And then the astronaut reading the story is like, well, that's a bunch of malarkey. And it turns out he's a monkey.
Okay. That's good. That's good.
So it makes for a good, you know, it's like a Jonathan Swiftian fable, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not particularly cinematic necessarily in its original form.
Right.
So I think... To me, I look at Planet of the Apes and I look at Jaws as two examples. They buck the rule of, you know, the novel's always better.
Mm-hmm.
I think both of these are examples where, no, I think the movie's better.
Right, yeah. Right. And I'm sure reading that for the first time was great, but they found a way to amp it up and make it more cinematic.
They did, and what's funny is Pierre Boulle was not a fan of the movie changing the ending of the novel.
Oh,
of making
really?
It Earth the whole time. I mean, obviously, I'm assuming once the royalty checks rolled in, he was like, all right, I guess it's okay, you know?
Yeah.
But
so
that's
now, and so you're saying they went to him for the sequel then?
Yeah, and he came up. So Serling comes up with an idea that after the events of the first movie, Taylor is, you know, trying to you know, escape the apes, and various shenanigans happen. They find the remains of like a human city with like you know, old World War II airplanes or whatever. And there's like a final battle, and then another spaceship arrives. Of humans who are like, hey, Taylor, like, come back with us. And he's like, no, give me like one of your women to stay here with me. And we're going to screw and start a colony. And that's like how the movie, that was how his, I'm not joking. That was like his idea.
So
I'm assuming Nova dies at some point.
Right. Right. So he's like, well, I'm not going to leave this. I'm going to reclaim Earth.
Exactly.
Essentially what he's. Okay.
Yeah. And so, they were like, okay, we're going to, thanks for that. You know?
Thank you, Rod.
And so then Pierre Boulle comes up with an idea that kind of the same thing where Taylor and Nova have a son. They end up founding a colony, and the son ends up being far more hateful of apes than the father. Taylor dies partway through, and it ends with like a reversal where humans have reclaimed the planet, and you have like Dr. Zaius in a cage at the end, and he, you know, the trainer's like, oh, can you say your name? And he's like, Zaius, like that. And that too was deemed like maybe not so good, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think so all of this was kind of being shepherded by Mort Abrahams, who's the associate producer, and his whole thing was we should have something comparable to the visual shocks of the first movie.
Right.
And when you look at movie one, you say like the hunt sequence is sort of indelible, right?
Right.
When we first see the apes on horseback, and that hunt sequence, by the way, is still like fantastic.
Yeah, yeah, it still gets parodied. I mean, that's what Anchorman.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, when they're rounding up everybody. That's
right. And then of course the ending. So
right.
I think the calculus was let's start with some big visual ideas and build a story outward from there. And so that's how with this movie we end up with, you know, the buried like city of New York, and then of course the mutants who, you know, with their weird skin masks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Chuck Heston did not want to come back, and
yeah, because he's sort of sequel averse, right? I mean, this was just a whole other era. I mean, were they done? Were they thought of as the absolute lowest of the low? Or
before Planet of the Apes, the most successful franchise other than like Godzilla, which was Japanese anyway, was like the Universal Monsters.
Sure.
Right? And the Universal Monsters started out as prestige pictures, and then as they went, it became kind of schlockier, and by the end, you just had, like, a big monster mash. Let's just put all the monsters together. And so it became kind of a low rent, right?
Mm-hmm.
I have an affinity for all of those, but, I mean, you can see the trajectory. And, I mean, to some extent, the Apes films do mirror that. Heston, to the best of my knowledge, Beneath the Planet of the Apes is the only sequel he ever did.
Hmm.
Which says something, right?
Yeah.
And so he had no interest. And it wasn't like he was holding him up for money or anything like that. He didn't need the money. He was just like, we told the story.
Mm-hmm.
The story is this particular arc following this particular character. And as he said it, anything after that is just more, it's like Adventures with the Monkeys.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, and I think there can be fun in that, but I think he's right.
Yeah, exactly.
And it is a perfect little capsule, you know?
Right, and certainly the original film, you don't have to watch any of the ones that come after it to enjoy and appreciate that movie.
Mm-hmm.
It exists as an island unto itself. But regardless, he was cajoled into coming back. Cajoled is the wrong word. I mean, he was guilted into coming back. because essentially, you know, Heston put his own credibility into getting the movie sold and picked up by 20th Century Fox. Richard Zanuck, who was the head of 20th Century Fox at the time, the movie comes out. It's this big success. Everybody benefits. So now they're like, let's do the sequel. Heston's like, no thanks, right? Mm-hmm. And Zanuck is basically like, he sends his lawyer a message like, you know, I put my ass on the line to get this movie made. Mm-hmm. I did you guys a favor.
Right.
And now I'm asking you to pay that favor back. And like, what the hell, right?
Right, right.
And so Heston's like, all right, jeez. You know, he had no particular enthusiasm to do it. But he was like, look, I'll do it. Just like, kill me off quickly. you can say I'm in it. And we can move on from there. And right. And he's like, and it just so happens that like Heston's kid and Zanuck's kid like both went to the same school or something. So he's like, I'll just give my salary to that school and we'll just call it even. Like,
oh,
that.
Really?
Yeah, which is nice, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's where James Franciscus comes in, and I find it fascinating. I mean, I think he's fine in this movie. I have no problem with James Franciscus, but he is. He's like made for TV Heston. Like if you did Planet of the Apes. The TV series, which they did later, but like based on the first movie, James Franciscus is who you would cast as Taylor.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, just looking at him on screen,
right?
A little bit earlier. I mean, he looks like he could be his stand-in, isn't right, but I mean, like a double or something, right? Yeah, absolutely.
Right. You know, so
should we acknowledge these effects? This is like a big effect sequence.
Yeah, they exist.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, obviously. They're not living in the era we are, but it's just kind of funny. These little lightning bolts.
Yeah,
actually,
you know,
that's really cool.
I think that they did what they could. I mean, it's worth pointing out the first movie had like a $10 million budget, mm-hmm. and so they're like, oh, let's do more because it was such a big.
Oh my
success.
Gosh, $10 million.
Am
well, I believe you. I just like that's. I saw what the budget was for this one, and wow,
they cut it in half. I know that.
Yeah.
So. I believe the budget for this was $5 million.
Okay.
Unless I'm misremembering, which
I think I'd seen that it was even lower. I want to say that it was like 2.5 or something.
Okay, so then you're right. They spent about $6 million on the first one. They cut it in half for the second one. And they kept doing that. With each of them, they kept cutting it down and down.
Lower and lower. Wow.
Isn't that interesting? Which is the exact opposite of what you do today. Because you know, they spent about $275 million on the fifth Transformers movie. Which is how we do how we do things now, right? But they cut the budget substantially. And you can see the effects of that later, especially in the big crowd scenes with all the apes. But even stuff like this, I think, I don't know if more money would have solved some of the schlock aspect of like what we just saw. Like right here, when Heston disappears into the wall. I mean, it's cheesy. There's just no, you know, and I think it's interesting because I think that. What we just saw, where Heston disappears into the nothingness there, that's one of those instances where suspension of disbelief breaks.
Mm-hmm.
Not because of the effects, but because it sort of, in a way, violates the reality that the first film created.
Sure, yeah.
If that makes sense, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it wasn't like all the apes were psychic or something.
Yeah, exactly, right? So and I think there's a storytelling lesson in there, which is you have to establish the boundaries of the world early. And once you do, you're pretty much stuck with that.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I think that applies whether you're talking about a television series or you name it.
Yeah. What is that, like, litter that just whipped... by the horse.
it's like a
damn
like
it
a,
Jensen, like some sound guy, you know, like,
it's like a 7-Eleven Slurpee cup. Yeah. Like, oh damn it. so you know, I think part of the problem with okay, we move Taylor off the stage and now here's new guy, and it's like, mm-hmm. we got to get new guy caught up,
right
and but the difference is now we as the audience are like, yeah we know this already.
Yeah.
Right? So the first, gosh, like third of the movie is just, you know, it's the first movie on fast forward.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. This isn't related, but sort of related. I watched that Seth Rogen movie, An American Pickle, mm-hmm. the other day.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's like this guy falls in pickle brine and is preserved for 100 years and wakes up in modern day. Huh. And so then what happens is these scientists kind of check him out and they go on the news. And the reporter's like, how are we supposed to believe that pickle brine could preserve a man for 100 years? And then basically the guy says the answer and it's like narration covers it up. And then it cuts back to the reporters and they're like, oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. Okay. It's like, let's just, you know what? We don't need it. Just
yeah.
But yeah,
I think this right here is important. I think this is a great character right here, Ursus, played by James Gregory.
Yeah.
Who's known for a bunch of stuff, who was known for a bunch of stuff. They actually offered that part to Orson Welles.
Yeah, that'd be something.
That would have been something. Now right here, look at the apes. You can see that most of these apes are just wearing pullover masks. If you pay attention during the crowd scenes.
Budget.
It's very apparent.
Yes. Yes.
Now that being said, I think the makeup on General Ursus is fantastic. I think it's emotive. And he makes for a really, you know, great addition to the mythos. I think, you know, this sort of xenophobic military figure that makes Dr. Zaius seem moderate by comparison. That's kind of interesting, right?
Right. Man, if I was like squinting, I would think that was Heston.
Right. Yeah, that exactly. You know, amazing. I mean, it's interesting to me that they didn't go in a completely different direction, you know, cast like a black actor or something, you know, like,
right.
To really draw up the distinction.
Right.
And you know, that today that would absolutely be the case. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this set
where is
right
this,
here,
by the way, I was just about to ask about the set.
So this set is, you see it in the first film. It's where, you know, when Heston is on trial and he comes out and he finds his fellow astronaut who's been lobotomized.
Mm-hmm.
It's the exact same set. They just redressed it. They added the lawgiver statue at the top, but it's exactly the same thing.
Right.
See that there? You know, that's David Watson as Cornelius. And looks like Roddy McDowell to me, you know?
Right. I was going to say, this makeup is really impressive. I mean, you can obviously tell it's makeup, but it's just really on the apes that are done up better than just the pullover masks.
Yes.
I mean, it's really emotive and it blends, you know,
with
their face. Like their eyes blend into the prosthetics all around them. And it's, I don't know, it's kind of impressive.
Yeah, I think, I mean, like I said, when you look at James Gregory there, I mean, you know, it doesn't look like a mask, you know?
Yeah.
It looks like a face.
Like his teeth and everything, the way his mouth's moving, it's pretty good.
It's, you know, Roddy McDowell and Kim Hunter were the veterans, and, you know, by the third one, they talked about how the key to emoting through the mask was your face was like 200% of what it normally is. In order to get like just normal reaction through the mask.
That makes sense.
And it's wrong to even call it a mask. I mean, it's an appliance, but you know what I mean?
Right.
Right. And yeah, right there in that shot we just saw with all those orangutans, you can see those are masks. Look at right here.
Horrifying.
Look all around. Those are very obviously chimpanzee pullover masks.
Yeah. They have this sort of ghastly eye.
Yes.
Sunken in eye look.
Now, the first film was an implicit critique of Vietnam-era militarism. Not textually in terms of anything in the film, but implicitly by virtue of where the movie ends, right? We did this to ourselves, you know, you blew it up, right? This movie is much more overt with that.
Right.
In casting the ape empire, if you will, as parallel to the American empire. And especially later on where you have, you know, the youth who are protesting and saying no more war, you know?
Right.
You know, it's interesting because for some people that's kind of hits you over the head with it. And I can totally see that, but I'm also of the mind that, well, this is a film series that kids are going to watch. And for kids, it'll play at exactly that right level.
You know, that's interesting. I know these movies only as like classics, right?
Right.
But who were these movies aimed at? I mean, was this sort of a four quadrant picture, so to speak, or was this aimed at young people, or was it aimed to be a prestige?
I mean,
you know, the first one at least. I mean, what, yeah, what's the?
I mean, you're talking about an era where the rating system was in its infancy, right? So
right.
It the idea was, yeah, you make a let's talk about the first film. It's a prestige picture because it stars Chuck Heston, who does important movies. It's written based on the book by, you know, the guy who wrote Bridge on the River Kwai. It's written by Michael Wilson, who wrote Lawrence of Arabia, Rod Serling, who created Twilight Zone. I mean, and all, you know, Kim Hunter, Roddy McDowall, Maurice Evans. These are not schlock actors.
Right.
So it was aimed at a non-sci-fi audience, but it was also aimed at a sci-fi audience, and it was aimed at kids who are going to be like, hey, talking monkeys, that's kind of crazy.
Right.
So it really was a four-quadrant picture, you know?
Did they have, by the way, we got to point this out, the steam room.
Yes.
The apes hanging out in a steam room is hilarious.
With their big monkey suits.
Yeah.
Literally.
I love it, though.
I wonder what James Gregory and Morris Evans were thinking as they sat there, like, between takes, you know?
Well, I love that all these years later, after apes have sort of evolved and created their own society, they still behave where the muckety-mucks talk business in a steam room.
Which, when you think about it, I mean, that is sort of the statement that the movie's making, and why, in a way, it's even darker than the first movie, which is... We screwed up. We human beings, we screwed up. We got replaced. And the people who replaced us are just as awful.
Right. Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Anyway, you were saying. I'm sorry.
Oh, I was going to ask. So, did they have action figures? What was that like? I mean, that's a big thing that gets spoken about with Star Wars in 77, where, you know, Lucas got the toy rights because people didn't realize how lucrative that was. But what was this? I mean, I'm pretty sure they... I've seen one, like an action figure, but what was that like?
So there was a whole raft of merchandising, you name it. However, the merchandising did not start until all five movies were over.
No kidding. Really?
That's true. Yeah. So, the third film came out in 73. So you had about a year lull between movie five and then the television series. So at that point, 20th Century Fox is like, hey, we should merchandise this.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, they started manufacturing a whole bunch of, you name it, coloring books and model kits and trash cans and obviously action figures. A toy company named Mego, who I don't know if you're familiar with, but they were before Hasbro and before Kenner, as far as action figures, Mego was like the place for licensed action figures. So they did, 8-inch, superheroes and whatever. So they did Planet of the Apes. Of course, it was too expensive to get actor likenesses for Charlton Heston or any of the humans.
Sure.
So it was like all apes, and they had like the generic astronaut.
Oh,
and so that's kind of interesting.
Yeah.
But again, that all started after. And I've said this before, but when Star Wars became a thing, same studio, Fox, they were like, well, if we're lucky, it'll be a hit like Planet of the Apes.
Right.
Which is ironic. I do like, by the way, we're talking about how easily you can confuse James Franciscus for Charlton Heston. First thing Zira says there when she sees him, she's like, Taylor? Because...
Right.
And, makes sense, because for humans in the ape culture, I mean, they all would look kind of alike.
Right, right.
Why wouldn't she think he was Taylor?
Now, he, if I read this correctly, he was kind of a TV guy?
He was, yeah.
Is he kind of like a Rick Dalton figure, DiCaprio's character? I was thinking about that, because then I was reading that, he came on here, was excited to do this, and... From all reports, he was taking this very seriously on set.
He did take it very seriously. He rewrote a lot of his dialogue, and he had a good relationship with the director, Ted.
Yeah, Forrest, I saw he did that. He reworked the script. That's something.
Yeah, because the script was not what it could be. I think the script had a lot of potential, and I'm sure you would agree. It was maybe like a draft or two away from really being what it needed to be.
Sure.
And so what Franciscus felt, and like you said, he was primarily known as like a TV actor. What was it called? Mr. Brooks? I think that's right. He was on a TV show called Mr. Brooks. He died, by the way, in the early 90s. And I think it feels to me, and obviously I'm biased, but it feels to me like this is the role he's probably best known for.
Sure. Yeah. No. The reason I even made that comparison was I was looking through his credits and saw he had, you know, he was on Combat and some of the shows that were referenced in the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood that I made night.
Combat. Yeah.
Only would know through that
movie. Mr. Roberts was the show, by the way, not Mr. Brooks. Sorry, Mr. Roberts.
Mr. Roberts. Oh, Mr. Brooks. That makes me think of that Kevin Costner movie. Remember that?
That's right. That's the one I'm thinking of. Anyway, he took it very seriously, and he wanted. I mean, understandably, he wanted Brent to be kind of more of the engine driving the story.
Sure. Yeah.
I think the problem is that Charlton Heston casts a very long shadow. He casts as long a shadow as the Statue of Liberty. Mm-hmm. So, through no fault of James Franciscus, as soon as Taylor leaves the story, you're like, all right, where's Taylor?
Right.
And that's what he's doing too, but it's almost like you want to follow whatever he's going through.
Yeah. The Phantom Zone he entered.
Yeah, right, you know. Cuz clearly by the time we see him at the end, he's been through some shit.
right.
It's like, "Well, what happened there?" you know. And then at the end when Taylor comes back into the story, the center of gravity shifts in his favor again.
Sure.
And Brent becomes a little bit, and through no fault of the character or the actor, he becomes a second banana.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think structurally, I don't know how you lick that. Like, I don't know that there was a way to solve that other than to follow through on Heston's request, which was just kill me off in the beginning and just be done with it.
Right.
You know, if you make his death more definitive at the start, then maybe, you know, it allows the audience to move on.
Yeah.
Not to say would have liked that either. Yeah. You know, I don't know.
Well, I was going to say, or you make, the new lead's journey just really, really compelling. You know?
Right.
Where you throw something at him that is just completely unfamiliar, and we're like, huh? And so we're curious how he's going to get out of that.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think...
Tricked into being endeared to him.
That's actually a good point, you know? And I think that, points to sort of what makes this film series... different, and what I think makes it worth visiting is every movie is so different from the one before it, you know?
Yeah.
Arguably, this one is the closest, obviously, to the previous one, but then, you know, about halfway through, it takes a hard left into something very, you know, but, and in hindsight, that's one of those things that to me makes it, well, it's something different.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And then, in the third one, well, you know, you're not going to confuse any of these movies with the one before it.
Sure.
And, you know, I think as a kid, maybe, I probably disliked that about the films. Like, oh, why aren't they more like the first one? But as an adult, I like that.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, you know, each time out, they were doing something totally different. They just swung for it.
Yeah. I remember one time you telling me what each movie was.
Yeah.
And they were so wildly different.
Yeah.
And the settings were so wildly different that is why I had any interest in watching them. Because it was like, I don't need to see the first one 5 times.
Right.
But those twists and turns, I'm like, well, what does that look like?
Right.
You know, you put these characters in those crazy different situations. That's interesting.
I think so, you know. And when you think about the modern studio approach to franchise filmmaking, I don't think you would get that.
Yeah, oh, it's totally risky. I mean, we have all these years later to admire it. But yeah, I can imagine at the time, you're like, oh, just do what everybody likes.
Yeah. It's tricky because that balancing act, how do you construct a sequel, right? Because you with a sequel, you need to thread the needle. It needs to be similar enough to make you, you know, to remind you of what you liked. But different enough to make this journey worth going on. And you and I know, I mean, we talk about this enough. How many part twos really are able to stick the landing that way, you know?
Right,
right? I mean, it's Godfather 2, Empire Strikes Back. It's a pretty short list.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. That's why we've spoken on this, but why I really admire Back to the Future 2 so much. Yeah. They go crazy different for the first half, but then they literally drop you into the movie you loved already, but from a new angle. And it's just they completely use the tools available to them by the nature of their story. And it's just, you know, I know emotionally people have maybe not as like it as much as the first one, but it deserves to be admired.
Yeah, I think any time you leverage a very popular brand that obviously means, you know, a significant investment from a studio, and you flip the script a little bit in a way that's creative and different, I appreciate that. And so with that context, I'm able to appreciate a lot of things about this movie. It's not my favorite among the sequels, but it's a hard movie to hate, at least for me.
Yeah. It's funny too. I watching the scene we're watching now where they're being hunted.
Yes.
It's I have like dual feelings. One, it looks like something you and I could go do. Like right. they're on a grassy hill, you know, and I could put on an iPhone and you could put on a mask and we could shoot this. But then also I mean I kind of like it, cuz then it adds to the groundedness of the world, right?
Yes.
So I mean it's kind of works in its favor to be a little bit lo-fi. But it, you know, it's interesting. I was reading about this wondering, like, why would you give a sequel less money, right? But yep. I guess the studio itself had just had three massive bombs, right?
Yes.
So it was just sort of, they had to, if it was going to happen at all.
Well, and also, Brian, I mean, the conventional wisdom at the time was sequels always do less.
Right.
Which just is not the case anymore. You expect the sequel to match or exceed the one before.
Exceed, yeah, because then more people are probably going to show up.
Exactly.
Who liked the first one, right?
But this is, I mean, pre-home video.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You don't have the opportunity to really build up that audience from the first one. So I think with each of the films, they cost less and therefore made less, but relative to the investment, they did well, and that's why they were able to keep going.
Right.
And I think with this one and the fifth one are the ones where the budget constraints are most apparent. You know, because with the third, you said you've seen the third one, right?
Yes. So that's the one that starts on the steps on Earth.
It starts with the ship in the water.
Okay.
That's where Cornelius and Zira come back in time.
Yes.
And so that one, they cut the budget from even this one, right? But you say, okay, well, you just need like the two apes.
Right.
And you just shoot it in downtown LA. You know, so the story suits the budget, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's
how did this one perform then? I mean, sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No.
But I mean, with cut the budget, I mean, was this a success?
It was a success, you know?
Yeah.
It was successful enough to warrant going back to the well and to keep going back to the well.
Mm-hmm.
So it cost...
Goodness, he looks just like Charlton Heston.
I know, right?
Sorry. It's just incredible.
It cost like between $3 and $4 million. It made like $20 million domestically.
Whoa.
You know, maybe another 10 or 20 worldwide. So it's, let's say $40 million.
Holy cow.
Yeah. I mean, big success, right?
Yeah.
So it makes sense that the studio, after this is over, they're like, hey, we got to keep going, you know?
Right.
Even though the end was about as definitive as it gets. But we'll talk about that. We'll talk about that.
Yeah. I remember you pitching me this movie before I'd ever seen it. And I was like, wow.
Yeah.
That's crazy. And there's a sequel?
Yeah. And there's three sequels?
But yeah, you're right. I mean, this is, I feel like I'm watching the first movie again.
Yeah. It's like listening to a podcast at 1.5 speed.
Right. You know, you got sort of the scaled down hunt where they're captured in nets.
That's right.
And then you got.
Now this is all, I mean, you know, with the first movie, they went to like Arizona and they, you know, they really, there was a sense of scope and scale. That adds so much, and you know, I revisit that movie regularly. And to me, what's astounding about the first film is you don't have to watch it and be like, yeah, but it, you got to remember it's 1968.
Sure, sure.
Like 50 plus years later, it just, it's a movie that is confident in itself. Whereas I think with this one, I mean, you do have to sort of apologize for it a little bit, you know?
Sure, sure.
Well, they didn't have that much money, and well, they, you know.
Right. Oh, wow. At first, I was about to poke a little fun at the scene, like it's like a lo-fi Raiders truck right. chase, but...
That's not bad, actually.
It's going
kind
of slow, and there's a green screen. Pretty well. Or not green screen. Rear projection. But then now, yeah, I'm like, oh, wow, they're going really fast. That looks dangerous.
Like, there's some rear projection there.
Sure, sure.
But, like, the wider shot, you know?
Ooh. Yeah.
You know what's also interesting, and I as I recall, we made a similar comment when we did the first movie, but, like, you know, you look at James Franciscus, and, like, nowadays you'd be like, wow, he's kind of, you know, wiry, right? But back
oh,
then...
Oh, actually,
Like, back then, yeah. That was considered buff.
It's funny, I was going to point that out when Heston was teaching her English.
Yes.
I was like, well, that's a body I could aspire toward.
Right. Now, what's funny, by the way, and I was going to mention this earlier, that scene you mentioned, it starts with, you know, he's talking to her, and she points to him, and she's not able to speak, and he's like, here you go, and he takes his dog tag, and he puts it over her head,
yes.
And that's the thing that Brent sees, right, and that's how he's able to connect the dots between her and Taylor, right?
Right.
The question is, where did Taylor have that dog tag?
Did he? Yeah, because he's not wearing them.
Right. Did he have a keister this whole time?
I remember watching, he pulls them out of his shorts.
Which makes no sense.
Yeah, no, I don't know why you would do that.
So
I wouldn't want to touch them after that.
He had keistered those dog tags.
He keistered the dog tags.
That's the only explanation that works. He pulled it out of his asshole and he at some point washed it off and put it on her, you know.
That would be actually hilarious. An alternate take if then he hands them to her and she's like, no, you know, like, no, really, this is important.
Because in the
you
first film,
I'll read them.
If you remember in the first film, right, they take off their astronaut suits and they go swimming and then the people like tear up their clothes. And then, you know, when when Taylor is captured, he's divested of those clothes and he's given like dirty human clothes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if those apes had seen those dog tags, that's it. Game over, right?
Right.
So there's actually no way he would have those. It makes no sense.
Right, right.
But, you know, you see the screenwriting at work, like, oh, well, we got it. How would he even remotely connect her to Taylor?
Right.
So,
right.
That, you know, how about this, you know?
That's really funny.
I mean, when you think, the odds of her stumbling upon him.
On planet Earth, yeah.
Yeah, is itself, yeah, pretty, yeah.
Yeah.
It's funny, too, because there's all these, like, little continuity mistakes. Like, in this movie, when he lands and, you know, the captain of the ship is like, oh, did you see the time readout or whatever? He says, yeah, it said 39:55. Whereas mm-hmm. in the first movie, when Taylor sees the time reader, it says 39:78.
Oh.
And you say, well, that's like one of those mistakes. Like, that's one of those things where you say, okay, well, maybe there was like a screw up. Like, his ship, the thing stopped working earlier or something. You can find a way to mistake, you know.
Sure.
To screw. But in the third one, Cornelius and Zira, they're in Taylor's ship. And they're like, yeah, it said 39:55. Which, like, or 39:50 something. This is one of these things where it's like pedantic. I don't really care, but it is funny to me. Like, guys, why not just pop in the movie?
Right. I was just going to say, it didn't have to happen.
That's right. I mean, you know, I'm not like flip the table over and screw you, storm out, you know? But it is like, well, you could have just like read the script. That would have done it.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Now, so this right here was all James Franciscus.
This?
The whole monologue here where he's like, you know, what happened? How did we do this? Etc.
Oh, I see.
That was him just being like trying to give himself some some sense of momentum in the script where he's driving it. You know, it's his angst.
Yeah, which is good. I the reason I reacted like that was because I thought you meant the whole underground
right
angle of all this, which I was like, that's great. I love
no,
that.
No. Well, the underground angle really was that was Paul Dane.
Okay.
The idea of the mutated humans. And like I said earlier, I mean, it's almost like that was the starting point for the story. To be like, oh, yeah, we got to have these mutants, and then let's go from there, you know?
Right. Right. But yeah, no, this whole angle really speaks to me. Like, this is something that I love and delight in. Like, you have the first film, then you wouldn't assume that it's Earth. That's the twist. But then now that we know that, let's see the remnants of Earth in this strange sci-fi, you know, affected existence. Like, that's the stuff. I love that stuff.
And the thing is, I mean, we are now literally halfway through the movie.
Wow.
Yeah, we're at the exact halfway point. And you imagine that the original conception of the script, you know, the Brandt character was Taylor.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so you would get to this place much sooner.
Right.
But it's like, oh, well, we got to get this new guy and we got to get him caught up.
Yeah, it's a long time.
Yeah, you know. So to me, all the stuff with the mutants, I think tonally it is a little bit dissonant with everything that the first movie established. But I think it's interesting. I think it's visually interesting as a sort of a matter of world building. I think they did an interesting job, you know.
This could be one of those things where I've said, I'm not comparing this to Batman and Robin, but like I said with Batman and Robin, I used to kind of hate that movie because it was so nuts and weird. But now that there's like 10 Batman movies, I don't mind that there's one that's kind of wacky.
I totally agree with you.
Right? So it's, if this was the second movie, I could see people being like, what the heck was that?
That's, you know, that's the interesting, what you just said, like, I'm genuinely curious. What were audiences thinking when the screen went to black and the lights came up?
Yeah, yeah.
The first time, you know, because you watch this now and you're like, well, there's three more of these things, so this is just one part of the story. But if, as far as they knew, they had no reason to think there would be more of these movies coming.
Yeah, and like I admire that this one's kind of nuts.
Yeah. Yeah, I totally agree. And my relationship with this film has changed in that sense. Because I remember when I first watched it, it was after trying desperately to get a hold of it and find it somewhere, you know? And so I had a lot of...
Can you imagine that time?
Yeah.
People? It was like you couldn't get your hands on a movie. I mean, now it's... Right? And what I mean is, you know, either your video store wouldn't have it, it would be checked out, right? Or something. But now, I mean, you can... Everything. You can stream anything.
I remember, because I watched the original film in like 88, 89, thereabouts. And it was very hard to get a hold of in Saudi Arabia, but a friend had satellite. And so they got me the first one and the third one. So I loved the first one. And I watched the third one and I'm like, well, clearly something massive happened in the second one that I don't know about, you know? And that was very frustrating. Right. And then, by the way, right here, this is what I was talking about. Like, the Vietnam War parallel is made, like, it's not subtext, it's just text, you know?
Right, 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 right.
But, you know, for a good 4 years, I tried to get a hold of the second movie, you know, and move back to Chicago. And I would call up various video stores and they'd be like, we don't have it, you know?
Right, right.
And then finally, my cousin, they had like a USA marathon and they showed up all of them. So they recorded it for me. That's how I saw it.
Oh, that's nice.
Probably like, I want to say like 93, thereabouts.
Okay.
So when I saw it, I was like, oh, that was okay, you know? Right?
Yeah.
And it's because of that, because I was like, well, I want something. This is the one that's like the first one, but it's not like the first one.
Uh-huh.
So the very thing that I disliked then is what I like now.
Right, right. Yeah. As a part of a group.
Yes.
Right.
But here are these cheap masks again. You can see if you look at the gorillas.
Yeah. By the way, so looking at this impressive shot with all these extras, and it makes me think, too, when you saw it, you probably saw it on TV, standard def. Yep. Square.
Yep.
Makes me appreciate now too that any movie I want to watch that I've never seen before, you know, I think I watched The Conversation recently, which I'd never seen.
Oh.
I was like, wow, I get to watch this in high def, widescreen, exactly the way it was meant to be. I mean, yeah. Good time. It's a good time for entertainment.
It really is. I think about it all the time because I remember my journey of trying to get a hold of the various Ape movies, and now it's like I'm sitting here watching it on my tablet with you.
Yeah. Yeah.
See, so this whole monologue that Brent has, where he looks at Nova and he's like, are you what we used to be before we learned to talk and made a mess of everything? That was a full-on James Franciscus edition.
Huh.
And I think it's good. I think, you know, the character of Brent is not particularly developed.
Yeah, sure.
In the story. Like, I think with Taylor, you have a clear sense of who he is. I mean, in the first, long before the apes show up in that movie, which is about the halfway point, you get a sense of who Taylor is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's misanthropic and he's arrogant. And I mean, he's a real asshole, right? And that's
he doesn't like humans.
He does not like people. And that's the paradox of the movie.
Yeah.
The guy who hates humans has to defend humans. That's interesting. I think with Brent, other than this right here, we don't really occupy his headspace.
Yeah.
Because so much of the film is constructed as go from point A to point B to point C, move through the story, you know?
Yeah.
And
at the top of my head. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, you first.
I think that points to what I would argue is a mistake in the construction of this movie, which was let's come up with the visual hooks and then build the story around that, because that's not what the original movie was.
Right. You right. Know?
The visual moments grew out of the story that they had created.
Right.
But you were saying?
Oh, no, I just off the top of my head. I mean, this is...
Actually, real quick, Brian, I'm sorry. I just want
to
mention.
Yeah,
no, yeah. These apes right here who are just talking and they're just like, yeah, this sucks. Oh, what are we doing here? I don't know what the hell's going on. I love the, like, stormtrooper-esque banter between
them. Yes, yes. You see,
like even among these apes, there's like the working class Joes.
Yes.
You know?
I like that too.
Yeah. Anyway, sorry, you were saying.
No, I'm just watching the scene where he's looking around the subway and everything and just remembering how it was. I kind of yearn for a scene, and this is the bad version. That's a very popular phrase in writer's rooms. Anytime you say something, you have to diffuse it first. This is the bad version. I like if there was, say, even like a husk of a taxi cab,
sure,
you know, and then he is like, oh, like a, we used to get around in these things, you know, and like he goes in there and puts her in the back and like treats her so she gets to see what life on Earth would have been like. And he gets to touch something from like a experience that he knows he'll never have again. Like I almost yearn for like a moment like that.
I think you're right. And yeah, like you said, maybe not as on the nose as what you're describing.
Yeah, I don't even know how that would work.
I think
something like that.
Just something, and I think this goes to what Heston's issue was with the whole idea of doing a sequel is, you know, if the first movie is about the journey that this character, this arrogant man being brought low, that, you know, it's like an O. Henry story, you know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the problem is, well, who is Brent, right? He can't just be Taylor, except in the superficial way that they made him Taylor-esque, as opposed to tailor-made, right? you know, so I think that's the problem is that, I mean, we go along with him. We don't dislike Brent because it's like, well, he's the guy and we're following him and that's fine. But who is he?
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah, what does his journey do to him?
Yeah, and I think what's also interesting is how, you know, following this movie just as much out of necessity because of budget reasons, the whole fulcrum shifts and it's now focusing on the apes. So the apes are our protagonists as opposed to antagonists.
Right.
And that too is very telling because that's just the direction that the entire franchise went up to and including, you know, the most recent films.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, all of this, like, I think on a production design level, I think it's very impressive.
Yeah, I agree.
Especially given what the constraints, you know?
Yeah. By the way, how great a role would Zira be? Where you have absolutely no lines.
You mean Nova?
Nova, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree with you.
Yeah.
Yeah, and she's, I mean, gosh, she is just gorgeous, isn't she, Linda Harrison?
Oh, she's beautiful, yeah.
And yeah, she was dating Richard Zanuck at the time of the first movie, which is how she got the gig in the first one. And she did end up marrying him, I imagine, after this. But it's kind of nice. You come back and, you know, you just, you got like one line. Sure. And now this shot right here with him looking out, that was like on the poster.
Oh, okay.
And that was the hook, right? The Planet of the Apes was just the beginning. What lies beneath may be the end.
It's good.
It's a good hook. Now all this,
yeah, as an New York Public Library.
Yeah, it's. I mean, they built some of this stuff, but for the most part, especially like this shot coming up where you see them walking across the landscape, is his production designer's William Krieber. He went to New York. He took pictures. And he just, like, cut him up.
That is great.
Isn't that great?
That's great, yeah.
And it totally works. That shot of Radio Music City Music Hall right there. He cut up the pictures, kind of did a little, you know, I was going to say Photoshop, but, the analog equivalent of Photoshop.
Yeah.
And it did the trick.
You know, all things considered, I think that shot looks great.
I agree. Now, I think, you know, what's interesting to me is the relationship this film has with religion. And it's clear that Paul Dane had a very cynical view of religion. And in terms of how he approaches it from both angles, both in terms of the mutants and also the apes. Because we see a scene before the apes... you know, the army leaves where they're in church basically. And you have the ape priest kind of saying this prayer, and you see Ursus, the ape general, very cynic, you know, just sitting there. It's all bullshit to him.
Right. Right.
And he kind of the prayer, and he's just like, amen. You know, and he's using, religion as a cudgel. And, you know, we see that too often in this day and age.
Absolutely, yeah.
You know, I mean, you can draw a straight line to, you know, Donald Trump standing outside the church in Washington a couple of weeks ago holding up the Bible.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, weaponizing it.
Weaponizing religion, right? Oh, God chose me, right? And yet, see, this is what I think sort of is the genius of the story construction, is the human mutants are no better.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're doing the exact same thing.
Right.
You know, they're like, the bomb is their God, right? And the bomb is a holy weapon of peace.
Right. That's right.
And think about the inherent contradiction just in that sentence.
That's why I chuckled, just that sentence alone.
You know, you don't even have to say anything else that happens in the film. You say, well, that's an insane thing to say. And yet, you tell me, Brian, that sounds like something, people anywhere on this planet would say without irony.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Too many,
you know,
too many.
So to me, when the movie gets into this area where it does this kind of commentary, that's where it really excels. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. That's why, you know, it's funny. I read a review, by the way, we should talk about what's happening right now.
Yes. So Brent is just choking the life out of Nova because the mutants have gotten his head. We don't know that. We don't know why he's doing it.
Yeah.
And I actually think that's kind of a problem because we don't have enough of a grounding with his character to know that that's not something he would do.
Right. And can you imagine her? Like, she's like, I finally meet a man.
Yeah.
He's the only one. And by the way, they're drinking out of this, like, New York public fountain, which I would not recommend.
Yeah. That's a good point. Whether it's flowing or not.
Yeah. I couldn't believe he was drinking that still water that was...
Yeah, I was like, you know, maybe just smell it.
You're right.
You know, smell it and stay away from it. So I love the juxtaposition of the cathedral being, you know, the cathedral of the bomb.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
And yeah, I don't know. There's just something about this that's just so dark. I love that they went there.
I totally agree.
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, I think that's something that I appreciate more as time goes by, when you're able to just go balls out for the very dark ending.
Absolutely.
And, you know,
I agree.
This is, I say this all the time, and you know, with Terminator 3, which is not a perfect film, but I think that ending of that movie raises it a whole letter grade for me.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. You know? Yeah, the perfect end to that series, frankly.
I would agree. Yeah. I definitely agree there. Now, this actor here, that's Gregory Sierra, who he went on to, he was in like Sanford and Son later as the neighbor. Mm-hmm. He was also like Sonny Crockett's like captain in the early episodes of Miami Vice.
Oh, interesting. This actor, that's so funny. Those are two shows I, of course, you could reference and make jokes and I would totally get it, but I've literally never seen one episode of either.
Really?
Yeah.
I would say watch Miami Vice. You've got a good show waiting for you.
Yeah? It holds up?
It absolutely holds up, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
I kind of know it for the sort of viscera of it, you know, the sort of 80s pink t-shirts and white suits and whatever, yes. But I actually couldn't tell you how it's regarded, like if it's actually sort of just a pop show or if it's actually like a really good drama.
I think that unfortunately it's sort of lumped in with the, you know, 80s schlock.
Sure.
But it's a very good show.
Okay.
So you got a good show waiting for you.
Nice. Check that out.
So all this now Paul Dane, the writer, he was a poet before this. He wrote Goldfinger, actually, the movie Goldfinger.
Ah, okay.
And so, you know, he grew up in the post-atomic age, or not, I mean, he not grew up, he lived through that era, right? Mm-hmm. And so this notion of atomic destruction was very much at the forefront of his thinking, which is, I think, why this film is as dark as it is. It was indicative of his own, you know, fears, right? And it just so happens that mm-hmm. this is a franchise that suits that message.
Mm-hmm.
And you see where you know, through the mutants, we see like a projection of Brent being led through their society. I wish we would have got more of that. Like, I feel like if this movie was made today, we would follow Brent from his point of view as he's seeing the various aspects of mutant society, mm-hmm, as he's mm-hmm. led to here. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
And really focus in on that. And so you see these kids in a circle dancing and they fall down. And that's a variation of Ring Around a Rosie, where it's like ring a ring of positrons, a pocket full of neutrons, you know, fission, you know, like.
Yeah, right.
You know. Now, the council here, the mutant council, the heavy set guy on the left, in the red, I think he's mm-hmm. Victor Buono, who played King Tut in the Batman television series.
Oh, cool. That'd be a fun series to go through.
That's another one.
Yeah. That was when I went out and actually got the Blu-rays, but I haven't really done that.
You haven't
that guy looks
it?
Like the warden from Shawshank.
He does. You're absolutely right.
Yeah. This staircase, too, it reminds me of the staircase in The Matrix.
Oh, in the second one, right? Around. So this this is a leftover set from Hello, Dolly.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that they redressed.
You know what? That totally makes sense. I was going to say, it's kind of interesting grand staircase. It was enough for me to actually think about it. So that's really, well, clever.
Yeah. See, so all of this here, right? So they're communicating through his mind and all that. And again, I think it feels tonally mismatched with the world that the first movie established.
Right. Right.
And I it goes back to what I was saying. Like the first movie establishes we're in the future and humans are like this and apes talk. And it's almost like that's the boundary. Like whatever you do next has to fit within that.
I agree. I'd almost appreciate it more if they didn't have powers.
Yes. Yeah.
And they're just crazy.
That's, you know, yeah, what I mean? That's a good point.
And they've set up this whole, they have to live within the boundaries of our reality, but they have set up this whole, you know, skewed, weird way of living.
I agree. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, I think, you know, I'm reminded of you know, there's an episode of the old Incredible Hulk TV show where Kenneth Johnson, creator of the show, told a story about how Stan Lee showed up for filming of an episode or something. And there was an episode where the Hulk fights a bear. Okay. And, okay. And Stan Lee's like, can't you make it like a robot bear or something? And, and Kenneth Johnson's like, no, because audiences won't buy that.
Hmm.
Right. And it, I was like, that's very interesting because you've established that you got this guy that when he turns angry, he turns into a big green guy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But like, that's the limit.
Right.
Right.
Right. I'm trying to think how you would even accomplish that, a robot bear.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking in post.
Come on,
you
true
would
believer.
All his roars with like roar, roar, you know, but it looks like a regular bear.
See right there. Holy weapon of peace. I mean that it's I applaud the storytelling ending up at a place where it's like, this is not good guy versus bad guy.
Right. Right.
Right. This is just, two bureaucracies that are headed, in collision course with each other, and who suffers? The innocent people.
Mm-hmm.
Whether ape or human or mutant, it's just the innocent people are the ones who suffer because the end of this movie, it's not a redemptive ending, you know? I mean, I don't think, at least maybe this is just me, but I don't watch the end and applaud what Taylor does.
Right, right.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, worth mentioning that the woman mutant, her name is Albina, the character, she's played by Natalie Trundy, who was the wife of Arthur P. Jacobs, who was, of course, the producer of all these movies.
Hmm.
And she is second only to Roddy McDowell in terms of she appears in every single one of the films other than the first one.
Oh, as the same character?
As different characters.
Oh, okay.
So she's the mutant in this. In the third film, you have two human animal psychologists who work at a zoo, and they kind of like befriend Cornelius and Zira.
Oh, I see.
So she's the woman there. And then in the third and fourth one, she plays an ape. Sorry, in the fourth and fifth one, she plays an ape.
Yeah. That's cool. That's what I'd want to do, too.
I know. It would be fun, right?
Yeah.
It's funny because in the fifth one, you know, it starts with the we see the lawgiver, you know, who's only depicted in statues. And the whole film is a framing device told from his perspective. And he's played by John Huston, the you know, director, father of Angelica Huston. And I'm always like, wonder what he was thinking, like, as as he got made up like that, you know?
Yeah. Well, I can totally see King Tut now.
Yes.
Whenever it shows him his eyes. All right. King so what are they explaining here for people who haven't seen this film?
So essentially, right, Brent is in the situation where he's like, look, I was in Ape City and I escaped. And so they're like, all right, well, tell us about the apes. Do they want to make, do they want peace or war? And Brent is like, look, man, I don't want any of your shit. All right. Mm-hmm. Just get me the hell out of here. And he knows that, look, they're coming and they're, it's all bad news. Right.
Yeah.
And so again, they do the same thing they did before, where they basically force him to attack Nova, which it was hard to watch the first time. It's even harder to watch here.
Right.
Where he chokes her. He like kisses her and chokes her. I mean, they basically, in a G-rated movie, they force him to sexually assault her.
Ugh.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is messed up. By the way,
were there just two ratings back then, or?
Yeah. Right.
I'd actually, that's kind of interesting. I don't know a lot about the ratings board, but.
I'm curious, when did MPAA ratings start? Right?
Yeah. Okay. So I'd be curious, too, as a result of what? This is something.
So I'm looking, I just Googled it. 1968 is when the MPAA started rating movies. So right, either just after or just before when Planet of the Apes, the first one came out.
Right.
Right, 1968. So you probably, what, you had PG, you had G, PG, and R.
Hmm. I'm surprised that these movies aren't PG.
Yes, I definitely agree with that.
Yeah.
The only
it's like,
one...
Yeah.
The only one of these to be rated PG is the fourth one.
Hmm. Makes me think of 2001. I always just find it weird when you just see G at the bottom of the poster.
But that's,
that
I mean,
anything crazy there's nothing, it, but it's just weird.
Like, kids would be bored, but they wouldn't be horrified, I don't think, right?
Right. I'm trying to picture like a 5-year-old with that ending. Like, why is he aging so fast?
What's happening?
Yeah. Is there going to be a big black monolith at the end of my bed tomorrow? Yeah.
I had a friend back in the day who collected props specifically from the Ape films. And I remember he was able to get one of the background ape costumes from this sequence. And that was like a big deal for him. And I saw pictures and it wasn't like one of the hero shots, mm-hmm. you know, so it was like imitation leather with like stuff like drawn on with magic marker. Like, it's very cheap.
Oh, funny.
But it's meant to be just in the background, you know?
Yeah. But screen used.
Screen used. Yeah.
That's cool.
You know,
I love all this stuff when you watch these old movies and you can just see, you know, crowds and lines of people. It's just so impressive.
Yeah.
You know? You feel like you don't see that much anymore, obviously, because they can digitally manipulate it.
Yeah, nowadays you can just have like, you can have like two people and just duplicate them in the computer.
Yeah. The last time I remember being really impressed by that was The Dark Knight Rises with that riot at the end.
Yeah.
Like, wow, that's a lot of people. And knowing it's Nolan, I'm sure they were all there.
They were all there.
Yeah.
So. Let me ask you, you saw this movie relatively recently.
Yes.
For the first time.
Yeah.
So what was your, like, how did you plug into it?
What do you mean? Like, did I find my way in or did I just enjoy the surfaciness of it?
Or not enjoy? I mean, I have no idea what your reaction to the movie was.
I enjoyed it because I already knew what was going to happen because we had talked about it.
Okay.
And so having liked the first one, I enjoyed seeing more of the universe. And then the ending is just so bonkers. I think that I couldn't help but lean forward as I was watching it. Just kind of like, wow, where's this going? And, you know, so, yeah. I mean, but I didn't have like a huge investment in it.
Sure.
So there was nothing for me to lose per se.
I got you.
And I think that's why I was able to kind of watch it at a distance and have fun with it.
So it was not a RoboCop 2 experience.
I was actually thinking about that before we hopped on. Because I think with that in particular, that just came at a time. Because I was like, look, I mean, is it the worst movie I've ever seen? Of course not. But it came at a time when I was really, really busy. And if I had to say, do you recommend if you only have 2 hours in your week to watch something, would you suggest RoboCop 2? No. did I have fun watching it with you when I had nothing to lose? Yeah, that was fun.
Okay. So this right here, I think this is interesting in that we get this kind of ghastly image of this statue with the blood dripping from it. And again, when you say, God, this is a movie that kids are going to watch, and how are they even processing it, right?
Yeah.
But I think the fact that Ursus, who is earlier portrayed as being very jaded when it comes to religion, mm-hmm. here he's like, he bleeds. The lawgiver mm-hmm. bleeds. Like, even he is shocked, right?
Yeah.
And yet it's Dr. Zaius, who is the zealot, who recognizes it as a false image.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I, I, I think the character, I've said that, I'm pretty sure I said this in our commentary for the first film, right? Dr. Zaius is, you know, the quote unquote villain of the first movie, but he's the hero of his own movie.
Mm. Yeah.
And
which are always the best villains.
That's exactly right. And, right. You know, if you've seen the third film, you have there's the human scientist who's he's played by Eric Braeden, Dr. Hasline, and he's the one who ends up killing. He tracks down Cornelius and Zira, and he kills them. Right, so he's the villain in that movie. I'm like, well, he is just the mirror image of Dr. Zaius.
Mm-hmm.
And he's the character who wants desperately to preserve society. His society,
right.
You know. I think the undercurrent of just cynicism that's just laid throughout this film is gives such a unique window into Paul Dane's mindset, and it's carried through all of the films. It's what I appreciate about the, you know, these movies are very dark, right? And the mm-hmm. fact that they had the courage to be dark is,
yeah,
is,
and those I kind of like those types of stories because then they're fiction. And then we can take a step back and apply it to our world and hope for better.
That's right. That's exactly right, you know?
Yeah. They're like almost like warnings.
Yeah.
Oh, see, that's cool. I love this stuff.
Yeah, exactly. So we're looking at the wreckage of New York.
Yeah. Sort of a... Yeah.
So we have the... I mean, this sequence, to me... is, you know, you talk about bonkers. This is the most bonkers part of the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we're watching they're doing the Lord's Prayer, but
to a bomb. Yeah. Which it has the symbol of the Alpha and Omega on it, which is how God refers to himself at one point in the Bible. The Alpha
really?
And the Omega.
Really?
Oh, see, I didn't, the end.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, and this is.
Yeah, I'm trying to imagine if I had liked the first movie and seen this. Like I said, I kind of knew what I was getting into when I watched this, but I can imagine people going like, "What
the
what
hell?" Right? You know?
Yeah.
Is it the equivalent of going from Batman to Batman Returns?
Right.
You know?
Right.
Maybe even more extreme.
Yeah. But I wouldn't call it satire. What's the word you'd call it? Like sort of the cynicism or the metaphor or whatever it is he wants you to sort of feel during this. I just admire the. It is pretty bold.
Yeah, and I mean it's if not outright blasphemous, it's pretty much towing right up to the line, right?
Right.
Now, interestingly, I when I interviewed Matt Reeves, you know, for Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, this was 6 years ago now, he talked about how this sequence we're watching right here was one of his favorites, the whole thing, of the whole franchise. You know, he's a huge fan of the films, and he I think that shows in the two that he directed. But he talked about being a little kid and seeing these people pull their faces off and just being like, oh, my God, you know?
You're right.
And
right.
And that's my point. I mean, you take those big swings, and it stays with you. You know,
mm-hmm.
You can see a scenario where the studios like do something safe,
mm-hmm.
and something safe would be even more of a retread of the first movie.
Right. I'm like, just waiting for it. I'm like,
come on. That's right.
I know it's coming when they're going to take out their faces.
Now this too. Look at look at that.
Yeah,
the makeup effect of these mutants who—they pull their faces off and it is just kind of mutated by the radiation. It ain't pretty, but it looks really good.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. And
this they still resemble the actors.
Yes.
Right. They don't just look interchangeable. Yeah.
And it doesn't look cheap.
Yeah.
You know, it holds up, and I think Ted Post talked about how. Initially, they were presented with sort of mutations that were much more horrifying, like the concept ideas, you know, with like three eyes, one eye, just really messed up. And he got this idea. This was him looking at like an anatomy book of a face with the dermis peeled off.
Hmm.
And he was like, I feel like that would make more sense.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was absolutely the right call.
Yeah. Yeah. It's something where it's just a couple steps removed from something understandable that makes it more terrifying than if it was more fantastic.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know? And I think the way they're sort of in this zombified way saying, "Oh, things bright and beautiful." I mean, it's unnerving, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's the type of thing, you know, it is satirical, right? I mean, it's not being particularly kind to religiosity. Mm-hmm. You know, it feels of a piece with like what George Romero was doing right around then, you know, I think Dawn of the Dead was a couple of years after this.
Hmm. Yeah, but I've actually never seen the original Dawn of the Dead.
See, that's another one. I'd be very curious.
Night of the Living Dead, I suppose.
I think you should give him a shot when you get a chance.
Yeah.
I mean, you and I both do not particularly like horror movies.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a fan of what George Romero did, so maybe that tells you something.
Right. Yeah.
So here we are.
Just something striking. I was just going to say, seeing the person in the loincloth, and it doesn't seem crazy seeing them wander through grassy hills, but seeing them go through these underground New York sets, there's something really striking in it and intriguing about that. Sorry. Okay. What were you saying?
No, I mean, we've got about 15 minutes left of the movie, and this is where Chuck Heston makes his return.
Yeah. Where'd they have those clothes for him?
I know. That was I think that was another Charlton Heston thing. He's like, yeah, no. Give me something to wear.
Give me a damn jacket.
Now, I mean, look at how tall Charlton Heston was.
Yeah, he looks almost like a Hobbit-esque sort of visual effect.
Right?
Right? Where he looks just like a bigger constructed man.
What's fun? I'm
not
watching.
Just tall,
but
I mean, even look at his head, his shoulders.
He's just bigger. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm watching the television series with it is Moses, right? The Planet of the Apes television series from 1974. I'm watching that with my kids, and I'm just by chance I noticed the bars on the thing here. You know.
Yeah.
With the points, I noticed those same props being used for something entirely unrelated in an episode of the show.
Oh, funny.
Like, I guess they just kept that stuff handy, you know?
Yeah. Wait, what's the angle of the series? Ouch.
Right? These guys go to town. I wonder how much of that was scripted versus just James Franciscus, you know, being frustrated at having to act against Heston again.
It actually looks like a really effective barbed wire built into a cell door.
It
really hurt.
You wouldn't want to be thrown into that. Yeah. Yeah. Brent anyway, gets the worst of it. Brent gets the worst of it in this fight. I mean, look at that. You see the blood stain
blood. Yeah.
When he's slammed into the wall. Sorry. You were asking.
Oh yeah. The TV series. I mean, what is it? Does it follow the, last film, whatever that narrative is, or is it, its own thing, or what's the...
Yeah, so the TV show is set about 1,000 years before this.
Oh, okay.
So you have another couple of astronauts who end up, through a time portal, landing on Earth instead of 2,000 years in the future, 1,000 years in the future. So apes are in charge, but humans aren't animals. They're like slaves.
Hmm.
And Roddy McDowell was on the television show as well, actually.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So he was involved. I mean, he liked doing this franchise. You know, it wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
He stayed involved in it all the way up until his death, really, because he died in 98, shortly after the big 30th anniversary celebration of Planet of the Apes, and he hosted a documentary about the whole making of the mm-hmm. franchise, and he hosted that, and he very shortly after that he died of cancer.
Mm.
Really sad.
That's so cool, though. He really, it wasn't just a gig for him. I mean, it's something he really loved and he stayed loyal to.
He was proud of it, yeah. So here we have Nova speak, which, you know, is like probably the hardest acting that Linda Harrison had to do in this role, right? And right. You know what's funny is she talked to her. She's like, she felt embarrassed at having to sort of make this guttural sound, you know.
Uh huh.
But I actually think she does a good job with it.
Yeah.
Ooh. Like.
Ow.
Yeah. Ouch.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I mean, she
I
is
think that sometimes.
She is in have, essence yeah, an animal. Sorry, so she's an animal.
Right.
So
right.
How would an animal suddenly talk?
Yeah. Yeah, so, yeah, I can imagine that being on set, and you're like, all right, here we go, take yeah. one, and then you just throw something out there, and everyone's like, oh, that's what you're doing?
You that's know? Right. Yeah, the Ted Post talked about how the direction he gave her was basically, play it like you're trying desperately to understand what these people are saying, but you obviously have no way of understanding. So I picture like that Simpsons where... we get Santa's Little Helper's point of view.
Right.
It's like, blah, 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 blah.
Blah, blah, blah. Blah, 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 sit.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That's good. Yeah. I'd give her that direction. She'd be like, what the heck are you talking about?
Yeah, right. You know, like that Simpsons episode. That's what she'd say.
Actually, I was thinking... that earlier when he was talking to her with the dog tags and just thinking the stupid ways I would try to relate to her that she'd be like, what? You know, like, yeah, you know, that's impossible. It's funny because that's not how we say impossible. It's impossible. It's very funny from where I come from.
So this is where we find out that the bomb is in fact a doomsday bomb, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the idea that it was made such that the mere fact that it exists would be a deterrent, because if it goes off, it ends the Earth, right? And on the one hand, you're like, well, that's ridiculous. And yet on the other hand, you're like, that seems entirely consistent with something people would in fact do.
Right. Now, so where we're headed here, basically... whose idea was this? This is a very bold idea to just let's introduce a bomb and that could blow up and end life on planet Earth forever.
So
who came up with that?
Apparently, well, the idea of the bomb was baked into the cake because that was like Paul Dane's concept, right? That they worship the bomb. Mm-hmm. I think the idea of detonating the bomb was, by all accounts, a Chuck Heston suggestion.
Mm-hmm. So that was not the original plan when a bomb was introduced to set it off.
Yeah, I don't think they knew how to end the movie, which is a weird thing to be the case when you're making a movie, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And yet, and you can attest to this, how many movies start production with no idea how they're going to end?
I just can't wrap my head around that, but you hear it all the time.
All the time, right? And every once in a while, you work some magic, and you know The Fugitive is obviously the best example.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, that's a hell of a way to run a railroad, right?
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so with this, you know, Charlton Heston, he kept daily journals, just as a matter of course, which is, he was like, you know, that, you feel like that went out with Mr. Belvedere, like the idea of like every night the Owens family, you know.
Yeah, Wesley had a spelling bee.
Yeah, exactly. Pan over, woman in a bikini.
It went like... okay. Yeah. I just wrote a Mr. Belvedere joke.
Anyway, where was it? Yeah, so Charlton Heston, he was keeping journals. He's like, the Owens family was... No, but his whole life as an actor, he kept a journal. So they published a book like in the 70s, like an actor's life or something like that. And so there are entries about Beneath the Planet of the Apes, and he is so not on board. He's just like, I don't want to be doing this. It's another day of this movie. I'm sick of it already, you know? Now, to his credit, I got to say, his performance in the movie, he shows up.
Yeah, yeah.
And he brings whatever his gravitas is. He doesn't look I think it helps that the character is just fed up with this shit. So yeah. it's just all very method, right?
Yeah.
But he just was not having it. So I think when it reached a point where they're like, we don't know how to end this, he was like, bing, light bulb over the head. How about you have Taylor set off the bomb, and then that takes care of the mutants and the humans, and then in his head, ... and any more sequels.
Right. I don't have to ever come back here.
Yeah. And that was his whole thing. He's like, I think he was just like, how do I, you know, it's like Harrison Ford in Force Awakens, where it's like, so I get stabbed in the chest and I fall in the thing and the planet blows up, you know, like.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, he didn't want a monkey's paw his way into accidentally coming into another movie, you know?
Right. Right.
Now No, that's all.
That's a pretty, I remember watching the movie, I'm going to spoil this, so skip ahead 30 seconds if you like, but in the movie Melancholia.
Yes.
And at the end of that movie, I mean, the whole movie, like, I don't remember what it is, the moon or...
That's the Kirsten Dunst movie, right?
Kirsten Dunst, yeah. It's going to collide with Earth.
That's right, that's right.
And this dread is hanging over the whole film. And then at the end of the movie, I can't remember what it is, but the thing does collide with Earth. And all life is over. And then roll credits. And I remember feeling weird. And I got up and it just really affected me. And everyone in the theater too, you could just tell there was this like pall over the theater.
Hmm.
And so that's a really unpleasant, uncomfortable ending.
Yeah.
So, I mean, was there any resistance to this? Like, let's just end life as we know it. And at the end of this really popular so far series,
you know, I would assume that by virtue of the fact that it came from Charlton Heston, they gave it some weight. And certainly, I mean, I will say this: it's not an out of the blue ending. I mean, it is in that you don't expect it, but it fits.
It's sure, it does. It's true. Right. Yes,
right.
Yeah.
And I think to some extent, I mean, that says something about what audiences will or won't go for. And the movie did well, so clearly people showed up, right?
Yeah.
Did it get the repeat viewings the first one did? Maybe not. But I think the screenwriting lesson here is, and this is not directed at you, Brian, because you know better, but, you know, go for the truthful
ending. I'll take what I can get.
You go for the truthful ending, not the happy ending.
Sure.
If it feels honest, even if it's sad, even if it makes you feel uncomfortable, it'll be accepted.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? And I would say the same thing applies with Melancholia.
Right, right.
Because I agree with you, but I'm also like, yeah, but that was the right ending.
Right, right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's just... I just, you have a hard time imagining, you know, some, like Iron Man being like, it's what's best. Right. And flipping a switch and then you're like, oh, damn.
But by that same token, using Iron Man as an example, I don't think you'd find anyone who wouldn't say that the ending of that character was not truthful.
That's true.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. Man, something about squibs just hits differently, doesn't it?
It really does.
You're just like, ow, that looks like it hurts. See, you just have all that CG blood.
I think right here, right? So you've got the apes are going after the bomb, and you've got Taylor and Brent in the foreground here trying to contrive a way to stop it. But, you know, when you take a step out, you're like, what's the happy ending here?
Right, yeah, yeah.
You know?
Well, apparently, I mean, is this true? I read something about an alternate ending.
Are you talking about the
Taylor Brent Nova escape, and then it ends, you know, years later with Ape and Man getting along and coexisting?
That was one idea, okay. and included in that, by the way, was a ape human hybrid child that went that went as far as actually a makeup test.
Oh wow!
Which, like, guys,
yeah, right.
What are you implying here, right?
Right.
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 So in other words, we see the boundaries where it's like, okay, you can step right up to the line as blasphemy, but bestiality is like the bridge too far. Which, yes, I'm glad that line exists, 'cause
that's funny.
Now, worth pointing out, this bomb actually shows back up in the fifth film, which is set, you know.
Really?
Yeah, that film is set about 20 years after, you know, the quote-unquote present day.
Mm-hmm.
And so we see the beginnings of the mutant culture in the fifth film.
Okay, so they start hopping around in time.
Yeah, because, well, basically in movie three, we go back to the 1970s, and then we jump ahead at about 10-year intervals.
Mm-hmm.
Now, okay, right here, so there goes Ursus. Look at this. So James Franciscus is the guy. We've been following him around for the whole movie, and he doesn't just die. He dies horribly.
Right.
You know. And I do like this final confrontation between Zaius and Taylor, because it's just, it's them digging in on their respective, you know, right here. Yeah. Look at this. Look at that.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, he's Lord. Shot in the head, just crumples to the ground, a bullet-riddled mess.
Like Godfather.
It really is, you know?
Yeah.
So here goes Chuck Heston saying, "No more sequels for me," as he lands on right? And then I love, you know, we get Paul Frees' narration, and it's like he's reading, you know, the manual from some product. Like, he's so robotic. By the way, just for the sake of no reason, then it happens to have broken right now. Kamala Harris is Joe Biden's vice presidential nominee.
Oh, wow.
I'm just going to this moment in time as we were watching.
Stamp it in time. Yeah.
Anyway, draw no connections that happens right as we're watching the world blow up.
That's hilarious.
But anyway, the thing about the fact that we don't even need to see the world blow up.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? Like, there's many things I like. I like the fact that, I mean, they're like, look, we don't have the budget for that. Okay, so how do we do it? Let's just have the screen go to white, and let's just have this guy just say what happened. And, you know,
it's more chilling.
It is. I mean, think of it. The last 5 minutes of the movie, or at least the last, like, 4 minutes, certainly when Brent dies and when the world blows up, there's no music.
Right.
That's an interesting choice. They also, Paul Frees at the narration, he's like, one of the satellites of this star, this green and insignificant planet, is dead.
Right. I mean, I like that. It's so bleak.
I mean, that's like, you know, you kicking the corpse on your way out, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, to me, Beneath the Planet of the Apes is, forgive me, I can't even take credit for this. I saw somebody say this online. It's not a movie you can hate or love.
Hmm.
And I agree with that.
Yeah.
But I applaud it for all the ways it's so just different, and the stuff that is the weakest for me is where it is trying to, you know, do the karaoke of the first movie.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But what did audiences think as the credits came up?
Yeah, I wonder if they'd seen anything like that before. It kind of reminds me of that movie Failsafe.
Yes, yes.
Right? And right. That is just one of the most chilling endings I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And you don't really see anything. It's just brilliant editing and music.
That's exactly, you know? Right. Yeah.
Yeah. It's more haunting.
It's like with this, now you watch it and you're like, well, there's more story.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, there's three more movies worth of story. Oh, okay. Right.
Right.
So even that dark ending, you're like, well, we're still building a bridge to the next one.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're in the theater in 1970, yeah, what you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I love this franchise. I really do. And you've heard me talk about it enough, Brian. I don't need to keep going. But I mean, I think the creativity that the people involved were able to wring out of it, even with increasingly threadbare budgets, is mm-hmm. something I always applaud, you know? And the fact that here we are, gosh, 50 years after the second one, and it's still a living franchise.
Yeah.
That says something, you know?
We've gone through an entire other trilogy.
Right.
Let alone a remake.
And by the way, the fact that this new trilogy kept the tone, it stayed dark.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, and I think, I truly feel this way. I think that it's, even if you have a four quadrant movie, it's okay to go to that dark place if you're going to arrive at a place that feels truthful. And, you know, that's the stuff that stays with you.
See, and I think, it goes back to what we were saying earlier, where obviously the writer has a very cynical take on many things, right, that you can apply to our world. And I don't share those cynical views with him. But when you see, you know, like a fictional story through someone else's lens, it allows you to take a step back and just sort of re-examine and interpret the different outcomes and timelines the way that our behavior can lead us. And I think that, so then when you see someone taking these bolder stabs, you kind of admire them for being able to do that. And those things, like, those things stick with you. And
I think that's exactly right. You know, and what you said about not even necessarily agreeing with Paul Dane's cynicism, I think that's very, I'm in the same boat. I certainly don't have the same view towards religion that he does. Right.
Yeah. Same.
But like you said, I you can appreciate that there's a respect for authorial intent.
Mm-hmm. And then you're forced to process it through your lens and just sort of, you know, it's like, I guess what good science fiction does.
That's very true. I couldn't agree with you more. So there we go with Beneath the Planet of the Apes.
Yeah, I'm glad we did this.
I am too. This was a bit of a coin toss when we took this suggestion, but I think it took us in some interesting places.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm looking forward to, like I said a couple episodes ago, I want to go through the whole series now and kind of finish this out.
I would love to get your thoughts. I think especially the fourth one is fascinating because that's another one where they had very little money, and so they made do. Mm-hmm. They actually shot it at the mall right down by where you live.
Yeah, that's what I remember. That's what I was thinking of, I think.
Century City
when
Mall?
I mentioned the stairs.
Yes, that's right.
Yes.
That's the fourth one.
Right.
So the mall.
Oh, so maybe I haven't seen the third one.
Oh, well, there you
okay.
go.
Okay.
So you've seen the one.
Because I'm saying all these things. I'm like, remember this? You're like, well, actually, the third one starts like this. I'm like, yeah, but I've seen the third one. I've just been completely talking about the wrong film.
Well, then that's even better because you've got a good third. If you haven't seen the third one, you got a good one waiting for you.
Yeah.
Because perfect. I think the third one, in my opinion, is the best of the sequels.
Oh, great.
So there you go. Look at that. Everything's coming up, Brian. That's what that means. but we'll be back soon with our next regular show coming up. We got lots of news is happening, even as not a lot of new releases are happening.
Yeah.
So
yeah, it's kind of interesting.
It should be fun, and then we will of course have another commentary coming back as well. You know, Brian, this year is an anniversary of both Back to the Future and Back to the Future 3.
And
I feel like
85 and 90.
That's right. And I feel like, you know, maybe we can knock both of those out.
Yeah, I'm totally down. I just rewatched Back to the Future 3 on accident. It was kind of in the middle on TV the other night, and I just watched the rest. I was like, man, what a good even like the one that I know that people don't like as much as the other two. It's if that film is still a darn good movie, I mean, you got a pretty good trilogy there.
Well, folks, there you just got a sneak preview of our Back to the Future 3 commentary track. So that's coming. I want to do them both.
Yeah, let's do it.
So that we can expect some Back to the Future to be our next commentary.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, if you have any questions or comments for us, please hit us up at moviefilmpodcast@gmail.com or hit like on our Facebook page, facebook.com/moviefilmpodcast, and message us there. As always, please keep your comments and suggestions coming, and also go to iTunes and leave a review, leave a star rating. Every little bit helps. On behalf of my partner, Brian Hall, my name is Zaki Hassan, and we'll catch you next time. Thanks, everybody.
It's doomsday. The end of the world. Help me.
You ask me to help you? Man is evil, capable of nothing but destruction.
One of the countless billions of galaxies in the universe lies a medium-sized star, and one of its satellites, a green and insignificant planet, is now dead.
Lucky Land Casino, asking people, what's the weirdest place you've gotten lucky?
Lucky? In line at the deli, I guess?
Aha, in my dentist's office. More than once, actually.
Do I have to say?
Yes, you do.
In the car before my kids' PTA meeting.
Really?
Yes.
Excuse me, what's the weirdest place you've gotten lucky?
I never win and tell.
Well, there you have it. You can get lucky anywhere, playing at LuckyLandSlots.com. Play for free right now. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Hello, it is Ryan, and I was on a flight the other day playing one of my favorite social spin slot games on ChumbaCasino.com. I looked over the person sitting next to me, and you know what they were doing? They were also playing Chumba Casino. Coincidence? I think not. Everybody's loving having fun with it. Chumba Casino is home to hundreds of casino-style games that you can play for free anytime, anywhere, even at 30,000 feet. So sign up now at ChumbaCasino.com to claim your free welcome bonus. That's ChumbaCasino.com and live the Chumba life.
No purchase necessary. VGW. Void where prohibited by law. See terms and conditions. 18 plus.